Thank you. The final item of business is the Members' Business Debate on Motion 12335 in the name of Willie Rennie on flood management. This debate will be concluded without any question being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Willie Rennie to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr Rennie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. 7-year-old Amelia burst into tears at the bottom of the stairs in our house as the still unwrapped Christmas presents were swallowed up by the flood. Carol Ann watched her house flood, knowing there was nothing that she could do to protect it. She lost family pictures, personal effects and her home. Soon-to-be-married Nina had a buyer for the house and was ready to move to a new chapter in her life. But within minutes, the Ladyburn and Cooper burst its banks and flooded their homes with muddy, stinking water. Their distress has now turned to fury. Fury at all the talk, but no practical action. We've had talk about flood studies, management plans, strategies, capital programmes, planning enforcement, gully examination, attenuation schemes, SUD schemes, the promise of consideration of the possibility of government grants. If talk could hold back the water, we'd never have a flood in Cooper ever again. There has been lots of sympathy, but the residents don't want sympathy anymore. They know it's often used as cover for when those in power have nothing else to offer. Instead, when the Minister stands up, I want her to announce that the victims of Storm Gerrit will get the same grant money that the victims of Storm Babbitt have received. Just because the Met Office judged the storm yellow instead of amber didn't stop the floods. I've been told for months that it was being seriously considered. But how long does it take to consider a small grant scheme? So please give them the money that they deserve without any further delay. The section action I want today is direct support and clear advice for farmers and landowners along the Eden catchment to slow down the water's speed of flow upstream and to get it away quickly when it gets close to homes and businesses. Some people call it a catchment plan. Others, a river basin management plan. I don't really care what it's called. We just need a plan, and it's got to be an action plan. Despite all the good evidence about managing catchments, there is no plan, no money, confusing advice, and a costly application process if landowners want to do anything. Landowners are told by SEPA that removing silt from the river doesn't really work. But then they say there's no ban and permission can be granted. It's confusing. There is now a view amongst farmers and landowners that they will be wasting their time applying for permission. What we know and what we now need is for some public body, in partnership with locals, to identify the bottlenecks and the opportunities on the Eden and its tributaries and secure the necessary permissions so that the farmers can get the work done on their land. That action should be based on the best advice and evidence. We need a comprehensive approach because there is little point in one farmer getting work done in isolation. The whole river system, from bottom to top, needs to be considered. If those further up remove silt, for example, but those further down don't, the water will have nowhere else to go and will flood the homes again. Upstream, we need the same urgent, proactive assessment of the potential for fields and burns in the land to slow down the flow of the water and also reduce the loss of valuable topsoil in some location. The advice needs to be clear. Do trees make a difference? Are buffer strips wide enough? Does organic matter in the soil help? Do swales and reservoirs help? Should certain sections of land only be grass? Which sections should be given up for floodplains? Where could flood storage ponds be located? The Tweeds Forum partnership in the Eddleston Water demonstrates what can be achieved. But I repeat, advice to farmers elsewhere is confusing and conflicting, and there's no grant scheme other than for droughts and riverbank restoration. If ministers are honest, they will admit that nothing is getting done in most of the country. So it's all just talk. Today, I don't have my handout for a large, costly flood prevention schemes. They do have their place, but I know money is tight and that they take years. Now, what I'm asking for is smaller, faster, relatively inexpensive measures combined with a long-term plan to better manage the watercourses and prevent floods, if at all possible. It's a plan with relatively modest funding attached that is required. Now, I've been to lots of meetings in the last few months, meetings with residents, businesses, farmers, environmentalists, anglers, landowners, and they've all been packed. And whilst there are anxieties about how the possible clearing of rivers would be done and the impact on fish stocks and biodiversity, there is so much common ground. And I know there is a path to getting the catchment working to prevent flooding as much as possible and have an ecologically healthy river. But there is nothing proactive planned by the authorities. That is apart from Fife Council, with another flood study that will take years, then even longer to decide on action, then planning, funding and construction. Seven-year-old Amelia will likely be an adult before anything actually gets done. Yet we are repeatedly told we are in an emergency, a climate emergency. It doesn't feel like an emergency if you are a flood victim in Cooper. And it's not just Cooper. There have been floods in Dunshelt, in Muchtay, Strathmiglo, Kingskettle, Fruchy, and lots of other communities. It's not just happened once, so they live in constant fear that the water could come again any time of the day or the night. They know that the climate is changing and that there are more extreme weather events. But they also expect those in power to act, to do everything possible, not to give up on them. The good news is that Amelia will soon have a little brother or sister. Let's make sure that he or she doesn't live in the fear of floods in the years to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rennie. We now move to the open debate. Backbench speeches of up to 4 minutes. I call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Tess White. Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate Willie Rennie on securing this date, and thank Stephanie Callaghan for going all the way back to my office for my card, and also your own staff for providing one meantime. Flooding is an issue that countries everywhere are grappling with. Climate change means that flooding and other natural weather-related events are becoming more frequent, more intense and more destructive. One only needs to look at the events of last year. 2023 was the hottest year on record. This profoundly impacted the global water cycle and contributed to severe storms and flooding. The most potent example was eastern Libya, devastated by Storm Daniel, which killed more than 5,300 people and affected Greece, Turkey, Bulgaria and Egypt. Across every continent, flooding last year killed tens of thousands, displaced hundreds of thousands and impacted millions of people. Closer to home, the most severe and disruptive weather event was Storm Babet, with 7 lives tragically lost. Hundreds of homes and businesses were flooded, with Brechin particularly affected after defences were overtopped by South Esk River. Infrastructure was damaged, farmers lost crops and livestock, and around 30,000 homes in North East Scotland lost power during the storm. Unfortunately, we have to prepare for increasing frequency of such events in future years to come. Analysis from the Potsdam Institute of Climate Impact Research shows that climate models may significantly underestimate how much extreme rainfall increases under global warming, meaning that extreme rainfall could increase more rapidly than current models suggest. I'm pleased to see the increased need for investment in flood defences recognised by the Scottish Government. In the last year, Scottish ministers invested £61 million in flood defences, compared with the £4 million allocated in the first devolution budget. And since 2007, the Scottish Government has made a total of £814 million available to local authorities for flood protection schemes and other actions. Indeed, £48 million a year has been invested on average by the Scottish Government, compared with £12 million a year under the previous Labour Liberal Scottish Executive. So it's not just talk, as Mr Rennie asserts. Even allowing for inflation, this is an almost tripling of much-needed investment, which has enabled major flood defence schemes in my own constituency. The Upper Garnock Valley Flood Protection Scheme is now virtually finished, with only minor remedial and landscaping works to be completed in spring. The area has a long history of flooding going back to the late 19th century, and I well recall when the River Garnock burst its banks in 2008, with the emergency services from across North Ayrshire called to the devastated streets. And in 2020, a flash flood wrote off my car in Glengarnock as I found myself sitting in the driver's seat in 3 feet of water. The £18 million scheme provides mitigation options that have extended flood prevention to 600 at-risk properties in Kilburnie, Glengarnock and Dalry, and a number of major businesses. The £48 million Millport Flood Protection Scheme on the island of Cumbrae began last spring. Work is progressing well on construction of an offshore breakwater, which will create a calm area of water with completion due this summer. This part of the works is essential to allow a proposed marina in Cumbrae, which is an Ayrshire growth deal, to be constructed. Also in Millport will be the Millburn Flood Alleviation Scheme. This project will be tendered this year and constructed next year, providing protection for up to 124 properties in the island for a 1 in 200 years flood event. Sadly, the reality is it will not be possible to prevent flooding everywhere during extreme storm events. When prolonged and intense rainfall does overwhelm drainage systems, it's vital there's an appropriately swift response. Given the increasing frequency of flood events, organisations like Scottish Water need to up their game. With recent case work, I've found them responding regrettably slowly compared to in previous years, merely offering a phone number for constituents to call. That's simply not good enough and contrary to the excellent service provided just months ago. Presiding officer, we must also do more to raise awareness of flooding risks and increase the insurance uptake. In Scotland, the responsibility for protecting property from flooding rests with the owner. It's estimated that 284,000 properties in Scotland are at risk of flooding, rising to 394,000 by 2080 as a result of climate change. Despite this, I'm in my last few seconds, actually, I think.
The member is in his last few seconds.
I'm afraid. Sorry?
Yes, please conclude, Mr Gibson.
Oh, yes. Despite this, more than a quarter of households have no home insurance, with building and contents premiums rising a whopping 36% last year, a figure that will only increase. Those most likely to not be covered are the most vulnerable in our society, the elderly and low-income households, and we must look to see how we can protect them, not just their properties.
Thank you, Mr Gibson. I now call Tess White to be followed by Michael Barra. Ms White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd also like to thank Willie Rennie for securing time for this evening's debate on such an important topic. For those flood-hit communities struggling to get back on their feet in my region, it feels as though the magnitude of what happened still hasn't hit Humza Yousaf's government. The Scottish Government's ministerial task force met 1 month after Storm Babet wreaked havoc in the northeast. Communities were left in limbo for weeks, but the First Minister still managed to stage a photo op on River Street in Brechin within 48 hours of the storm. 4 months on, the people of Brechin and communities across the northeast are still hurting. The fallout from the flooding is still being felt. Repairs are ongoing. Homes continue to be uninhabitable. Businesses are trying to make up for lost time. Vital infrastructure has been badly affected, such as Marykirk Bridge in Aberdeenshire, with repairs due to get underway next month. Following Storm Babet, as many as 82 businesses contacted Angus Council looking for help, and upwards of 300 properties in Brechin affected by floodwaters. 57 council-owned properties still require significant work before they can be reinstated. We've recently learned that Angus Council's interim claim for the Belwyn scheme is £6.9 million, but that's just for immediate emergency response, not the recovery phase. Meanwhile, for many, the grants available for residents and businesses haven't touched the sides of what is required. And these adverse weather events are costly, both financially and emotionally, and they're happening more and more, with a record number of flood alerts issued by SEPA since 1st of September 2023. Since Storm Babet, some areas have been hit again by flooding, such as cottages in Castleton, which flooded in October and again in December. And for these residents and many others with their properties already compromised, This isn't going to stop. It's going to keep happening again and again. And that's why I've engaged proactively with communities throughout the North East on building resilience since I was first elected in 2021. Presiding Officer, Willie Rennie's motion rightly focuses not just on what has happened, but on how to get better management and how to better manage the risk of flooding in future. Information that I received from Angus Council via FOI has confirmed that no climate change adaptations have been made to Breakin's flood defence scheme since 2018, when the updated UK climate projections were published. It's all very well having flood protection schemes in place, but maintaining the defences and making sure that they take account of updated climate change projections is key to protecting our communities. I'm very interested to see the final output for the Scottish Government's National Adaptation Plan later this year, but it's vital that local and national partners work together now to make sure Scotland is not on the back foot when it comes to flooding. When lives and livelihoods are at risk, good enough isn't going to cut it. We need gold standard protection to keep our communities safe. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms White. I now call Michael Mara to be followed by Tim Eagle. Mr Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I also start by thanking Willie Rennie for securing debate? It's a very important issue which impacts constituents in our neighbouring regions. And severe weather events are becoming more frequent with each passing year. We can clearly observe them across the North East, and there's no doubt that climate change is the cause and is exposing our communities to ever greater risks. Dundee and the broader North East are certainly not known for heavy rainfall, but in recent years the frequency and severity of storms has increased dramatically, and the impact of flooding is devastating for families. Homes are ruined, livelihoods are destroyed, and lives are put at risk. And that disruption and upheaval caused when a property is flooded also brings significant costs. And in the midst of a cost of living crisis, Presiding Officer, this emergency expenditure is something most households and businesses can ill afford. And it's right that the government and local authorities step in to support residents at a time of such great need. But what I have heard from constituents and councillors in my region is that that process has been far from smooth. It's imperative the Scottish Government does learn the lessons for the future as severe storms become ever more frequent and takes a proper strategic approach to helping citizens as required. And the devastation that Storm Babet brought to Angus was clear to see, with Breakin particularly badly affected. And SNP-led Angus Council announced £10 million of funding following Storm Babet, and that money was very welcome. But 5 months later, we're still waiting for the majority of that money to materialise it. I would appreciate if the Minister, in closing the debate, could advise what the Scottish Government can do to support Angus Council in delivering that funding to those who actually need it. Funding... I'm certainly happy to.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank Michael Mara for taking my intervention. I wonder if you could outline what his views are. We know that local authorities have a role to play. We know Scottish Government has a role to play. But there are other public agencies that need to be involved in these discussions as well, as well as ensuring we have local community accountability. Does he agree that all of these people, all of these agencies need to be to get in the room together to ensure that we have a holistic approach to flood resilience?
Mike Mara.
I certainly agree with Maggie Chapman on that point. I think it's vital that the government uses its convening power as much as its financial power to make sure that these things are approached strategically. And we have to think about, as other members have set out, the long-term consequences of these changes. We have to make allowance in budgets to make sure that we have money set aside for these instances, and it has to be commensurate to the size of it. I'm sorry, I can't at this moment in time make some closer progress. So road closures across, funding of £1,500 for households and £3,000 for businesses as a result of Storm Babet was also very welcome, but only properties with indoor damage were eligible. And that money is a lifeline for people, but many residents sustained damage to the exterior of properties and have not received any support. Road closures have meant that other roads in the area are being used more frequently, increasing the demand for maintenance work through the displacement of traffic. But money is not being made available for those repairs on alternative routes, which are a consequence of the floods in themselves, of course, as well. So it's clear, as members are describing, a more holistic view must be taken about the true impact of flooding on a community. So across Dundee and Angus, many constituents live in areas that are susceptible to flooding. Only recently, Claverhouse, parts of Millamains and other areas around the Dichty Burn were flooded, and Whitfield, where Old Toll Lone was flooded by the Fithy. There is clear that these impacts are taking place. It beggars belief, frankly, that Dundee City Council are continuing to try and build a huge secondary school on a floodplain that's been identified as such since the 1960s, and I fear only that that's going to cause more trouble in the future. But residents have faced repeated disruption from flooding, forcing them to evacuate their homes for a time, and many businesses have been lost. So it's a really important debate, and I think that if we can bring a clear view to the fact that we need a more overarching strategic approach that brings agencies together and makes sure that this funding is available, and I would echo some of Willie Rennie's calls to make sure that his constituents receive the urgent support that they require. Thank you, President Officer.
Thank you, Mr Mara. I now call Tim Eagle to be followed by Michelle Thompson. Mr Eagle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I join the others actually in welcoming Willie Rennie's securing this debate today. Actually, it is a great issue of importance and one that is coming up just more and more every year now due to the storms that we're getting. The focus of William Rennie's motion and much of the wider coverage on this issue has been on communities such as Brecon, which saw, unfortunately, just devastating levels of flooding. This resulted in severe damage to homes, businesses and amenities in the area. It also, very sadly, resulted in loss of life, and I want to offer my condolences to those families that were affected. I welcome the action of members from across the Parliament in calling on the Government to provide additional financial support for the homes and businesses affected. And actually, I agree with Mr Rennie's points about the need for more funding for both prevention and for protection of this in the future. However, whilst the Government eventually took action for those most impacted by the storms, communities in Argyll and Bute were less fortunate, where the unnamed storm of 7th of October and Storm Badrett, which hit Scotland 1 week later, caused extensive damage to homes, businesses and infrastructure. It was both disappointing that residents and businesses in Argyll and Bute were not eligible to access the Storm Badrett recovery grants, and that, as I understand it, Argyll and Bute Council were not invited to attend the Storm Badrett Ministerial Task Force. And given the impact that that's had on communities in that area that I represent, I would be grateful if the Minister may be able to provide some clarity on those matters in her closing remarks. I do welcome that Argyll and Bute Council were able to access Berwyn funding to assist it with the clearance of impacted roads, but it is worth noting that some local roads still remain out of service several months later. One road, the A816, saw more than 6,000 tonnes of debris block the road for over 200 metres. It trapped two vehicles in the process, but fortunately nobody was hurt. While Argyll and Bute Council have managed to open an emergency diversion route under convoy, the main A816 remains closed to this day, to the worry of many of those in the community. Roads like the A816 are not just essential access points to a community, but support the local economy, and many locals have raised concerns about the ongoing effects to their businesses. Other sections of roads, including the A815 and the A83, rest and be thankful, also witnessed smaller landslips. The A83, rest and be thankful, was an issue that my predecessor, Donald Cameron, campaigned on extensively. I welcome the fact that progress is being made, albeit slowly, to deliver medium and long-term solutions. However, major weather events, such as the storms of recent years, highlight the need for greater urgency to deliver the much-needed replacement for this critical stretch of road. I want to take this opportunity to praise the Council staff, particularly those in the Roads and Infrastructure Services team, who acted swiftly to put in place contingency measures and provide regular updates to local residents. Deputy Presiding Officer, the recent storms were among the worst to hit communities, and the increasing frequency of such events not only reinforces the need to continue to meet our environmental targets, but that greater investment in weather defences is still needed. Scotland has a unique geography. We are rightly proud of our rural and island communities, but we need to support them fully with the infrastructure projects that provide for access, emergency and the economy. Those projects need completed now, not later. Our local authorities are often the first to respond to such adverse weather events, especially in communities across the Highlands and Islands. So it is vital that they are properly supported and funded, and that the communities, such as those in Argyll and Bute, are not left behind. I really do hope that this debate is a reminder to the Cabinet Secretary and to the entire Government of the need for fair funding for councils and emergency funding to all those that find themselves in need. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Eagle. I now call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Rachel Hamilton. Ms Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'll just comment before I start, which I was trying to intervene to Mr Mara. I recently obtained an insurance quote, and one of them asked if I could confirm that my house was no nearer than 260 metres to any water course, which is a very, very good drive and a 7-iron to give you a sense of the distance, and I suggest that's the shape of things to come. Anyway, I speak today in this debate as a constituency MSP for Falkirk East, and of course this includes Grangemouth, and therefore I reference the vitally important Grangemouth Flood Prevention Scheme. And this is the biggest project of its kind to be embarked upon. Its progress, the process and outcomes will have a far-reaching impact on other flood prevention programmes, and I certainly don't underestimate the scale of the challenge we face. And I note the efforts with thanks of Jacobs, Falkirk Council and other key stakeholders thus far. The estimated benefit involves 2,760 residential properties, 1,200 non-residential properties, 6,025 people and 23 kilometres of roads. The impact of not doing, as we've seen adverse weather events increase, is incalculable given the importance of the location to Scotland's GDP. And as the Cabinet Secretary notes, and I quote from a letter I received from her in January of this year, the GFPS is exceptional in terms of scale and financial cost. It's the largest flood scheme ever proposed in Scotland, with a current upper cost estimate of £650 million. So it's also worth noting that the wider coastal management strategy and modelling for fluvial events is undoubtedly linked to whatever is designed at Grangemouth. Therefore, certainty and progression is necessary, not only for Falkirk East residents, but also for neighbouring local authorities. A number of consultation events have been held, and in January this year, Falkirk Council agreed to move to the next step in the form of scheme notification. And after this, the outline business case will be developed. However, the funding elephant remains in the room. The current status in terms of split of funding, that the Scottish Government bears the cost of 80% of the programme and the local council 20%, seems to me to be unachievable by either party. And rightly so, the Cabinet Secretary states, for the Scottish Government to utilise the entire annual Local Government General Capital Grant is simply not feasible. And therefore, I understand the rationale for removing the scheme from this cycle of funding and allowing the Scottish Government to make progress on a variety of other schemes. Various funding models and options have been developed by the Council, and the Cabinet Secretary has asked her officials to pursue a task force model and engage a Team Scotland approach. This is welcome. But serious conversations need to be had regarding funding to allow for the clarity in the staging. I, in a previous life, was a programme manager, and I was always very aware, without a clear line of sight for phases, considerable sums of monies can affect be wasted. And it's not unreasonable to assume that the pathway to completion may need to be elongated, reworked, and will inevitably turn out to be much more expensive. But clarity needs to be found for the initial stages and ongoing dialogue for subsequent stages. Now, I am entirely sympathetic to the predicament we all find ourselves in. And I note, thankfully, that the Scottish Government has no plans to claw back the £4.5 million underspend by the Council for the scheme, although I understand as yet there's no clarity on what, if any, conditions may be attached. So to that end, I'm grateful for the Cabinet Secretary agreeing to meet with me to discuss the GFPS in the near future. And my final point is regarding other stakeholders who have an interest in this area. These include RSPB, Climate Forth, Bug Life, Nature Scotland, etc. It will be vital to have proper co-design and a full engagement process on plans for mitigation and biodiversity compensation, ensure any environmentally negative consequences of the GFPS scheme are considered. The last thing anyone wants to see is objections from what should be partners in the scheme, and I hope to see their full involvement. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Thompson. I now call Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Ms Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Willie Rennie for bringing this very important debate to the Chamber. He shares the catchment management approach, which I've been advocating for a number of years. And we all understand the significant impacts of the flooding events that have had such a devastating effect on the safety and livelihoods of those that live in flood-hit communities across Scotland, particularly over the years in my constituency, such as Hawick and Newcastleton. And Storm Arwen in November 2021, Storm Babet in 2023, and most recently Storm Gerrit in 2023. Every major flooding event has an utterly devastating effect to local communities. And I think that's why each and every one of us are here tonight. And whilst flooding itself is not preventable, our preparation has to be much better. We cannot afford to lose any further housing stock. We can't afford to lose key food-producing land, and we cannot afford to let our salmon stocks go extinct. And that's not only from flooding, but from drought too. And it was quite interesting yesterday because I actually met the Tay Gillies Association in Blairgowrie, who are concerned that climate change is bringing significant droughts in late spring and summer, causing extremely low flows in our rivers and tributaries, and that's having a significant effect on the salmon spawning grounds. And it just seems so ridiculous that we just cannot get this right. We've got too much rain sometimes, but not enough at other times. I agree with Willie Rennie in terms of the government initiatives to mitigate the risks against flooding. I agree that so far, to us, it appears that it's all just talk. We know that the words from the Scottish Government have so far been fairly hollow. Their pledges have been lost in a vacuous echo chamber. Sadly, Presiding Officer, communities have suffered as a result of what this government has so far not done. They've been wholly unprepared for the flooding events. And with each storm, another stark reminder of the shortcoming of what the Scottish Government are doing is evident. In terms of what the SNP may say, that flood prevention schemes have taken time to develop and construct, I don't dispute this point, but they've been in power since 2007, and the 42 formal flood protection schemes proposed for 2016 to 2021, only 15 of those schemes have been completed, with an overspend of £25.8 million as of January 2024. And this overspend pales in comparison to the estimated overspend of the remaining projects that are still under development. Striking examples include an estimated overspend of £87 million in Musselburgh, £59.4 million in Stirling and £308.5 million in Grangemouth. And at what point will the Scottish Government admit that their current plan is not working? That is why this motion is so important. They are failing to deliver a coherent plan to mitigate this risk, to protect residents, to protect vulnerable species. They're leaving our flood-prone rural communities in the dark. In the 2021 manifesto, they pledged to tackle flooding by ensuring that trees, woodlands and natural resources play a key role in flood prevention schemes. But this year's budgets show that the AICS funding to farmers has been cut by £17.6 million, leaving farmers without that key support, without farmers being able to be part of the solution. Again, in response in this chamber in February, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands outlined the Scottish Government's commitment to consider flood prevention in the round. Now, I would like that the Cabinet Secretary would be able to, if possible, update this chamber on Marie Goujon's commitment to a meeting with key stakeholders, regulators and farmers, which she said was taking place in March, and I would welcome an update on that. I do welcome the calls to explore the benefits of a regional catchment management approach to flood mitigation, as stated in the motion. A catchment approach utilises both local and expert knowledge to deliver a sustainable plan to tailor what is needed. Such amazing projects such as the Findhorn catchment project or indeed the Eddleston Water Project led by Tweed Forum, is a really shining example of natural flood management. And I know that I possibly only have 4 minutes, so I've gone over time, Presiding Officer, but just to complete the argument that I don't believe the government are taking the right approach. The expected cost for physical flood defences are close to £1 billion. Natural flood defences can provide a real, and as Michael Morris used the word, holistic approach as an alternative. Roger Crofts, formerly of the SNH, believes the concrete-based approach is ineffective and out of date. And on that note, I just think that we need to ensure that we protect communities, we protect our endangered species, we protect biodiversity, and we need to ensure that this government delivers meaningful protection for these communities. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Hamilton. And I now call Stephen Kerr, who will be the last speaker before I ask the CABSEC to respond. Mr Kerr.
Deputy Presiding Officer, pleasure to follow Rachel Hamilton, who I think has given an excellent speech. And I thank Willie Rennie for his motion. And I'd also like to agree wholeheartedly with the speech delivered by Michelle Thompson. And I'd like to continue in the same vein, because last week I, with many others, I'm sure, attended a public consultation for the Grangemouth Flood Protection Scheme. And listening to the experts and the local community, the message was crystal clear. The Grangemouth Flood Protection Scheme isn't just an optional project, it's a lifeline. And the total cost at current prices of this project is £672 million. And as Michelle Thompson said, Falkirk Council is required by legislation to fund 20% of that total. And it's just not realistic. Falkirk Council cannot afford £134 million that the government, that the legislation, expects them to stump up for the scheme. Now, this is the same Falkirk Council, by the way, that is so underfunded by the Scottish Government that they just had to tap into over £20 million of reserves just to keep the lights on. And members will know that I am not the greatest fan of the SNP Falkirk Council, but on this, they are in an impossible predicament. The SNP Scottish Government must confront the reality staring them in the face, because Grangemouth must be a national priority. It is a lifeblood of our nation, generating 4% of our country's GDP, responsible for 8% of all Scottish manufacturing, 30% of all of our exports move through the port at Grangemouth. So the Grangemouth Flood Protection Scheme would save at least £2 billion. The economic impact assessments on this probably need to be kept live, but it's at least £2 billion in damages, including, as was mentioned by Michelle Thompson, at least 2,000 residential properties. And I thought one of the most compelling aspects of Willie Rennie's speech tonight was the human dimension of all of this, as we have seen at Brechin, in particular, as a result of Storm Babette. Now, let me just say, I cannot think that it would be possible for us to leave Grangemouth in this vulnerable position, in the hands and in the finances of a local authority teetering, as I think it is, on the edge of bankruptcy. Now, Tess White mentioned Brechin and Babette. I've just mentioned it. And I think, unfortunately, the Scottish Government does not have a good record of responding to crises such as those that occurred in Brechin last year, last October. And I would specifically draw attention to one quote from a Freedom of Information request I obtained that showed that the Chief Executive of Angus Council wrote to the Scottish Government on the 31st of October saying, and I quote, "It is concerning, almost 2 weeks on, that no officer in the Scottish Government has contacted myself to ask how we are coping as a council or discuss how the Scottish Government can lean into the recovery phase of Storm Babette." Now, Deputy Presiding Officer, this is simply not acceptable. Why, when the urgency of a situation is so clear, why did it take the Scottish Government so long to respond? That's in the same vein as the questions I think Willie Rennie was rightly asking. If I may borrow from Winston Churchill, I think these are situations that require action this day. There's something that this government needs to improve its performance in respect of. Action and delivery. So let me conclude with four questions, if I may, Deputy Presiding Officer. In light of the financial straitjacket Falkirk Council is forced to live with, what further financial commitment is the Scottish Government prepared to make to support Falkirk Council to move the flood prevention project forward? And my second question is, what economic impact assessments has the Minister received or commissioned in the event of a catastrophic event at Grangemouth involving the port, the industrial complex and the communities affected? My next question is, does the Minister agree with the figure that Falkirk Council have produced in their assessment of the economic impact of such a catastrophe as being at least £2.4 billion? And I think that's an important number because it puts the level of the investment required for this scheme into the context of what happens if we don't make this investment. And my last question, which I hope the Minister will take the opportunity to respond to, is what discussions has she had with UK ministers about the Grangemouth Flood Protection Scheme, specifically given the strategic economic importance of the port and the industrial complex? And I conclude by saying that the slow response we saw in Babet is not good enough. This cannot be a slow unravelling, because the consequences of inaction hurts communities, hurts people, hurts our economy, but above all, hurts our people. And so will the Minister please see a step change in response to this impending crisis?
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I now call on Cabinet Secretary Mary McCallum to respond to the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, thank you. And I'd like to begin by thanking Willie Rennie for bringing this member's business on an issue of great importance to me and one which I can tell is of importance to members across the Chamber. I should like to begin by recognising the dreadful impact that flooding can have on households, businesses and communities, as was very well narrated by Willie Rennie. And I also want to thank those who have worked tirelessly over, in particular, the recent winter storm period to support their communities in recovery. I am quite clear that flooding is Scotland's most significant climate adaptation challenge. And the damage from the 10 named storms that we've seen this winter makes clear the impacts of climate change in Scotland and that they are increasing. And I say they are increasing because it's the case. The number of properties across Scotland exposed to flooding is expected to increase by nearly 40% by 2080, meaning many more communities will be exposed. Reducing this exposure to risk, planning to do so, is absolutely critical. It will undeniably require considerable investment over many years. Taking just this budget settlement, for example, however, one which members will have heard ministers narrate a great deal, that it was the most challenging we've faced in the devolution era. Despite those circumstances, I was very pleased to be able to negotiate significant uplifts for my flooding protection and coastal change budget line, which will increase by 42% in the year 24-25 to £91 million. This is vital because councils are statutorily responsible for designing and building protection schemes within their communities, and the Scottish Government supports them financially to do that. And just in that regard, councils have delivered 15 flood protection schemes for local authorities since 2016, with five due for completion in the next few years through that cooperation between local authorities and government. Now, that is the ongoing annual funding that supports councils to fulfil their statutory obligation. However, in extreme circumstances, the Scottish Government can and will provide additional support. And Storm Babbitt, as has been discussed this afternoon, was one such example when the Met Office issued two highly exceptional red warnings for rain. These were issued for the first time since 2015, when members will remember Storms Desmond and Frank. Babbitt led to hundreds of properties and businesses across four local authority areas suffering inundation. I personally attended every single SCORE meeting during the immediate onslaught of the event, and the Deputy First Minister and I set up and run the Babbitt Task Force in the aftermath. That task force agreed a package of additional financial support for residents and businesses, again the first time that additional package had been required and negotiated since Storm Desmond and Frank. So that's the emergency support that we are able to provide. It sits atop that which Scottish Government already provide, including Belwyn Scheme, the Scottish Welfare Fund, and where occupiers of businesses are flooded out of their properties, the council tax and non-domestic relief schemes offer empty property relief. And just to give a bit of context on claims to Belwyn, in 23-24, I will do just after I've finished this point, the Belwyn scheme has been activated 5 times with a total forecast expenditure of £19.6 million. And I'll give way to William.
Willie Rennie.
Just so she's aware that people in Cooper are watching this debate this evening. What they want to know is the answer to my 2 questions. One, will they get the grant support equal to that provided in Angus? And secondly, will there be a catchment plan for the River Eden supported by the Scottish Government and its agencies?
Cabinet Secretary.
Very happy to work on the issue of the catchment plan. On the more immediate point about support to households in Willie Rennie's community, I absolutely have sympathy with what was experienced. That was communicated to Willie Rennie at the time. We have since reached out to Fife Council to have an idea of the impacted communities, and I remain open to providing funding. If Willie Rennie wants to come and meet with me about that, he's very welcome, and I will continue to speak with Fife Council about the impacted communities. And I can hear Willie Rennie is speaking from a sedentary position, but truly my door is open. He should come and meet me about the impacts. I'm a little short of time, but I'll be
Willie
happy
Rennie?
To.
I'm sorry, I'm shaking my head because this is what I've been told for 2 months. These people are desperate, they're out of pocket, and they need more than sympathy. So is the Minister going to end the consideration and just give them the money that they deserve?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I do have sympathy, but that's not the extent of what I have. What I'm saying is I'm happy to continue working with Fife Council as I have been. I rely on Fife Council to give to me the information about impacted communities, as I do rely on having meetings with local MSPs about the impact of that. And again, I offer the opportunity for Willie Rennie to come and meet with me about the impact in his community. Something that Willie Rennie also mentioned in his intervention and in his contribution was the issue of whole catchment management. I believe that approach is at the heart of sustainable flood management. We know that water doesn't respect property lines or local authority borders, and that's why the Flood Risk Management Act already sets out that there's a number of actors involved here. What our new strategy, I'm hoping, will do is something that I think we would all agree is required when there's an incident in our constituency, and that is oblige all of those different actors who've got responsibility when it comes to flood risk management, be that local authority, be it SEPA, be it roads, be it the Scottish Government, to collectively work together in the interests of responding to the immediate event and to helping communities in the aftermath. Presiding Officer, if I have some time in hand.
Yes, indeed.
Yes, I'll take the intervention.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you to the Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, can you tell the Chamber why just 15 of the flood prevention schemes have been delivered by the Scottish Government since 2016 out of a total, as you mentioned, of 42? And why was the overspend £25.8 million, considering this was way before inflation and the block grant has continued to increase every year on year?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm afraid Rachel Hamilton just does simply simplify what is a really complex issue far too much there. I did set out that, according to the statute, it is local authorities who have got responsibility for flood risk management, and the Scottish Government arrangement is that we fund viable schemes up to 80%. And I have mentioned we have funded that to the total of £42 million per annum over a number of years, and have added an additional £150 million over the course of this Parliament to support local authorities in doing that. I understand it's challenging for local authorities. We know that these schemes can create a diversity of views in communities. There are myriad reasons why these are complex projects. But what I'm absolutely clear about is we will continue to work with local authorities to protect our communities. Presiding Officer, I am conscious of time and I do want to conclude. I must just conclude, I'm afraid. I want to just be absolutely clear by reiterating what I said at the start, which is that I know climate change is creating and worsening the impacts of flooding in our communities. It is the single greatest adaptation challenge that we have in Scotland. But that's exactly why the Scottish Government is investing hundreds of millions of pounds in this multifaceted, complex yet vital area. It's why we are complementing that investment by working to bring all of those with responsibility for this together. I'm doing it in government, I have done it in my own constituency, and I know how frustrating it is for representatives across the chamber when you're in the heart of an incident. We all know the human impacts of flooding and the increasing risk, and I want us to work together to respond to it. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.